Welcome everybody to our 23rd Areopa webinar. Today we have the topic on how to develop a VS Code extension. And today I have David Veldhoff as our speaker. I'm very happy that he picked up the gauntlet that I threw at him. I asked him, would you like to present this? The background is that David is, let's say, on my team, if I want to call it that way. We're developing a VS Code extension to allow you to write test scripts, ATDD test scripts, and get AL code from that. David had already started to create his own extension, by the way, called AL Code Actions, but he probably will refer to that. And I leave the introduction of David to himself when he becomes the presenter. For everybody, yes, every time again, I'll repeat this for those who stepped in for the first time. Your microphone is muted and stays muted. You cannot unmute that. If you have questions, please post them. For that, we have the question window. Write them down. I'll be the moderator. And by the way, if you haven't seen that or know that, my name is Luc van Vught. I will be posing the questions. David and I have agreed that you will step in or say to me, Luc, feel free to step in now with questions so he can tell his story and then stop at certain points. So please post your questions if you have some. Yes, the recording, like any others, will be put on YouTube. Feel free to share it. Feel free to reference it yourself, to go through it, whatever. And maybe you could help us to get to the next stage of 400 subscriptions. I did put that we had 3,893 subscribers already on Twitter, but there was an 8 too much in it. 393, and we want to get to the 400. If you want to be in the known, this is the link to our newsletter subscription page. So use that. And yes, so we will have more in the coming weeks. And in 3 weeks' time, we will have Steve Endo, who's going to talk about how he got started with BC development from scratch, coming from, in his case, Great Plains from GP. And anything else we're working on, there's nothing set yet after that, but probably on November the 17th, we might have a next one. We're working on that, but everybody feel free to step in with topics and maybe to become a speaker yourself. And before I hand off to David, a last slide as thanks to our sponsor Fornav, which enables us every time to go online and use a GoToWebinar and share this knowledge with you. So now I'm going to switch to you, David. Let me do that. And yes, you can, I think, share your screen right now.
Yes.
And enjoy it.
So,
and yes, we have an experiment. As you can see, David had turned on his webcam. We never done that before, but let's see how that works out on the recording. And if it doesn't work out, and if you as a attendee don't like it that much, let us know. It's not about the face of David what I'm talking about that you couldn't like, but it's about the fact that we have him as with his webinar. So, David, up to you.
Yes, thanks, Luc. I want to show you how you can get started with building your own Visual Studio Code extensions. And before I step in right away, let me introduce myself. I'm David Veldhoff. I'm 26 years old, and I'm working with NAV, or Business Central, since 2014 at GWS in Germany. And I am the developer of AL Code Actions, which lets you create method stubs or extract some codes to a separate procedure or something like that. But won't make advertisement for that now. To the agenda. I want to do a lot of demo today, so I want to go directly in Visual Studio Code and show you how we get the extension, how we develop that. and I will tell you what I have prepared already. And after that, I want to show you how we can create a Hello World sample. If we've done that and if we know where we should look at, I want to dive a little bit more into building Visual Studio Code extensions by showing you some possibilities that you have. And I want to add a new functionality with you together, so that we have a code action which extracts a label to a local variable. If we've done that, I want to show you how we can interact with built-in commands which are delivered by Visual Studio Code, like go to definition or show all references and something like that. I will show you how you can use them in your own extension. And yeah, I put the last point here in parentheses, interact with other extensions. I would love to show that, but I don't know if we have time for that. So yeah, let's see how we are doing and yeah, look at that. At last but not least, of course, I want to show you how you how we can share our extension either as a VizX file or even or directly in the Visual Studio Code marketplace. Okay, so what have I prepared? I have set up a brand new Windows 10 virtual machine, so it's really quite clean. And I installed Visual Studio Code and two other things. So first Node.js and Hero Man. And that's just it's described in the docs of Visual Studio Code, and I will always refer to the docs as they are pretty good. Anyway, we'll just go in this webinar. I will go through the docs with you and highlight some points. Okay, let's open this one. It refers to Visual Studio Code, and here you have the topic API. And under the first point, you have get started, your first extension. And here it says at the beginning of the document that we have to install Node.js, as I have told that I already have installed that, and that we should install Yeoman by executing npm install Yo and generator code. I just executed that in a PowerShell script. And yeah, so that's already installed on my machine. But from now, I will do everything with you together. So I will execute this command, Yo code, which will execute a code generator. And let's look what's happening then. Yo code. And it says that I don't have execution policies, so let's set them to unrestricted for our current process and repeat that. So, and now we are executing the code generator for creating a Visual Studio Code extension. It asks me, what do I want to do? I want to create a new extension in TypeScript. Okay. What's the name of my extension? I will just call it webinar, but you can give it whatever name you like. So for my example, it was AL code actions. The identifier, I will take the default one, and the description I could enter something, but I will leave it blank for now. We can change it afterwards as well. Initialize the Git repository. Don't need it for my demo purposes, but of course I would suggest that you will do it if you are developing your own extension. Which package manager to use? I'm fine with npm, but you can use Yarn as well. And yeah, if I answered all these questions, it generates now some code. It creates some files, webinar, so a folder webinar with some files. And it already wants npm install. And yeah, that the npm install downloads some packages and installs them. And after that, it says your extension webinar has been created. Okay, that's it. To start editing with Visual Studio Code, use the following commands. So I will just switch to the webinar directory and I will open Visual Studio Code inside this folder. And here it is. That's the code that was yet, that was generated by the code generator. And I want to highlight two files mainly, which are quite relevant for developing your own extension. And that's the package JSON file. That's your manifest where you where you say how your extension is called, that was webinar, which version do you have, which description you have, and so on. This one is a quite important property as well. It says that you, for using this extension, you have to have the VS Code version at least 1.50. That's what this sign, this character stands for. So if there's someone which has a Visual Studio Code version 1.40, then he's not able to install the extension. So yeah, be aware of that. But now I want to highlight two properties which are quite important. The first one is activation events. That says when your extension is going to be activated. That means not all extensions are directly activated if you open Visual Studio Code. You have to explicitly say when you want to activate your extension. And in this case, that happens on a command, webinar.helloworld. Okay. Somewhere there will be something, a command which says webinar.helloworld. And as you can see here, it's under the contributes property. And here we are saying how we contribute to Visual Studio Code. And here we say we want to add commands. As you can see here in JSON, that's an array. And one command that we want to add has a title, Hello World, and it has the command ID, webinar.helloworld. That's something what we specify here. We can add multiple commands just by adding a new, new JSON object with a new title, a new command, and something like that. And we can as well add other things where we want to contribute. For example, we can contribute to menus, for example, to the context menu of a file or to the configurations. That's to the settings that your extension has some settings. Something like this you can enter here in the contributes command or the contributes property. Okay, so we are saying we want to activate our extension on the command webinar hello world, and we've said that we have set Visual Studio Code that the command webinar.helloworld should be triggered if we execute hello world from the command palette, which you know, where you can say download symbols and something like that. But what happens if you trigger the webinar.helloworld? That's not part of the package JSON. That's part of the extension TS file, which is listed under source and then extension.typescript. If we have a look into that, it has mainly two functions, activate and deactivate. And yeah, this is of course the whole code which happens on activating the Visual Studio Code extensions. So we are printing something to the console, congratulations, your extension webinar is now active. And we do one thing more. We register the command webinar.hello world to something. So we say Visual Studio Code commands, register command, hello world, do this logic, which is inside here. And yeah, that's for, if you don't know TypeScript, an anonymous function. So we are just simply showing the user an information message, hello world from webinar. To debug the Visual Studio Code extension, we just can hit F5 like usually. And what happens then is that this window is in a debug mode and another Visual Studio Code extension is opened. And you can see here that it has a prefix extension development host. That means that the extension which we are developing in the window in the back is installed in this window. And yeah, here we have our command hello world. So I will just hit Ctrl-Shift-P to open the command palette. And here we can see that there's a command hello world. That's the command we just edit. And I hit escape first. Sorry, because I want to show you the console. As you can see here, we have in the console already something like extension CRS AL language extension is now activated. And if I execute the hello world here, which was part of our activation events, then once we have congratulations, your extension webinar is now active. So it was really just activated now. And the command that, or the function that was that we just registered was executed. So vscode.window.showInformationMessage is a window which is showing some info here. And yes, that's it. That's our first Visual Studio Code extension. So we've added a command, hello world, and we put some logic in that. Yeah, that should. Yeah, that was a hello world sample. Let me just check. Yeah, as I said, what's important, we have the package JSON where we specify our activation events. We have the contributes where we say that we want to add commands or configurations or something like that. But it's not enough to just say that we want to have a command hello world. Of course, we have to put some logic in behind that. And that we are doing with vscode.register command. And this, the part which is here, has to be the same as the one that's here. Okay, that's it so far. Luc, are there any questions yet?
No, so far not from the audience. I had a question which you maybe pick up later, I don't know. Your message is now showing in that, let's say, pop-up message box or console, if you call that. What is the difference to get it there and to get it in the debug console or whatever?
You mean, and so I have once a debug console here and in my Visual Studio Code extension window.
Yeah.
And I have, of course, here another debug console, which is used, for example, by AL.
So your Hello World pops up on the right bottom side with that overlay dialogue.
This one.
Yeah, and what's the difference to get it there and to get it on the debug console in when using the extension, not when debugging the extension, but when using the extension?
It's totally fine. You can create a new debug console or a new output channel. It's I've never used the debug console, so don't know exactly. But what you can do is that you can create your own output channel, and that you like the AL language is printing something inside this output channel. You can print something in your webinar output channel. So yeah. It's just what you want.
But that you will do with a different command, I guess.
Yeah, that wouldn't be a show information message. That would be something like you would have to create VS Code dot, I think it's workspace, it's output channel. I think it's in some namespace. I would have to look it up. But okay, you have to look for output channel.
Yeah,
and then you can create an output channel, and to the output channel you can add, you can append some text.
I saw now some questions coming up from the audience. Let me pick this one out here. Let's go jump back into the small screen. Wait, why is that in the? Oh, here. Yeah, from Rick van Erp. He says, "I'm relatively new to this world, but the Hello World example was just VS Code extension that had nothing to do with Business Central." True, that's nothing to do as such with Business Central. It's just about getting a VS Code extension done. Yeah, okay, sorry. I could have answered it offline. Thank you.
Okay.
Continue, please.
Okay. Now I will go ahead with further possibilities you have. Because of course you just don't just want to put information message, and I want to show you how we can add a code action which has the functionality to extract a label to a local function to a local variable. Again, I'm pointing to the documentation of Visual Studio Code, and again we are. Everything that has to do something with extensions is here under API. And then under Weave, for instance, we have the VS Code API site. And here you, what I want to highlight is the language's namespace, because I think that's quite interesting, I think. Because what we can do here is that we can create our own register our own code actions provider. A code action is the light bulb. So if you hit control dot, then there's a light bulb to say, let me create a new function or let me create whatever. But we also could add a declaration provider or a definition provider. Maybe you noticed once this post of Eric Hugert. He said, man, it would be cool if F12, so go to definition, would have something, would point me to the onInsert trigger. The AL language doesn't have a definition provider for that, but we can do that on our own. We can say, okay, let's create our own definition provider and implement that. Furthermore, you can add a hover provider or a reference provider so that you have something like show all references and that you have something more there, and so on and so forth. There's a lot of possibilities you have. But I just want to show you how you have to read the documentation and how you have to work with that. So as I said, I want to add a new code action provider, which adds the possibility to yeah, so that we have a code action which extracts a label, a string to a label variable. Okay. It says under Visual Studio Code, namespace languages, we have the register code actions provider. Let's go into that. VS Code, namespace languages, register code actions provider. Here it is. Now he asks for a document selector. A document selector is simply a string. So with that, we say for each AL file, we want to have this code action provider to be asked if there are some code actions that we want to deliver. And now he wants to have a code action provider, and that's basically an interface. So I would just say new Areopa code action provider. That's an object which does not exist yet, but let me show you how you create new objects and reference to them. New file. .ts for TypeScript. And then I say I want to create a class which I export directly. And yeah, if I've done that, I can go back to the extension TS. And now I have a code action here which says he says he cannot find the name, Areopa code action provider, but now I can import this class for my module code action provider. Pretty easy. But he's still he's missing something, as we are not implementing the code action provider interface. The code action provider interface is you have to know that part of the Visual Studio Code namespace. So I will just copy this import statement and now I can say implements VS Code dot code action provider. And as you can see, that's an interface. And the code action interface defines the contact between extensions and the light bulb feature. Okay. And now Visual Studio Code tells me implement interface code action provider. That's it. I will hit Alt Z to make a break, line break, so that I don't have to scroll horizontally. You have here, we get a few parameters, document, range, context, and token. And everything behind the colon here is a return type. I don't like that syntax because I find another one much more simple, so I will switch to that. It says that we have that it returns a Visual Studio Code action or a Visual Studio Code command, and of that it returns in a way. That says it's in a way. And yeah, I would just say I will always return a code action. That's fine for the compiler because he's expecting a code action or a command. And yeah, that's it. I'm always returning an array of code actions. And so I can remove the throw error and instead return an empty array. And to see that that the code action provider is triggered, I will just show again an information message that says, okay, I was triggered. So, okay, that's it. We have our class, the Areopa code action provider. We are implementing the interface, so that's fine now. But as you can see, it's not enough to just register the command, because this one returns a disposable, and that one is again pushed to the subscriptions context. So let me do that as well. I will do that in a one-liner. I just say the return value of that is directly pushed to the subscription. Okay, now I have added my own code action provider. Cool, let's test that. Close that one, don't need that. Okay, let me, I don't know, is the screencast mode activated? But what happens is I hit control dot and it says no code actions available, and I don't get a message that my code action provider was triggered. So what happened? Quite simple, our extension isn't activated yet because we said it's only activated on the command hello world. So let's execute the command hello world and have a look at our debug console. Now it says our extension is active, and now you can see that I get an information message, I was triggered. And if I hit control dot, now there's always a new information message. So that's working. So the problem was, our extension wasn't activated. Quite bad. But we can fix that. So for activation, we go back to the package JSON. So it's mainly, we are mainly switching between package JSON and extension TS. And we don't want always execute a command so to activate our extension. But there's another option. We can say, we want to be activated on language, and the language we want is AL. So every time, or if once AL file is opened, then our extension gets activated only then. And the other time our extension isn't, it won't be activated. Let's test that. It's directly an AL file activated, so you can see directly, congratulations, your extension webinar is now active without executing the command. Cool. That's it. Now I don't want to I don't want to return an empty array. I want to do something with the information I have. So I have the document and I have the range. The other two parameters I will leave out for demo purposes, I don't need them now. A document, so a Visual Studio Code text document object is something that represents the text file. So we get the text from that. We get how many lines this file has. We know the file name of that and all these kind of information. And the range is simply something, if I've selected something, it gives me the start and the end position. So I can say document dot get text, and that has it says it expects a range or undefined. Again, it's TypeScript specific. The type says that you have, that this parameter is of type range or undefined. And I will give that the parameter. So with that, I'm getting the selected text, because this one, the range, the text I'm currently selected before I hit the code action provider, before I executed that one. and I want to store that into a variable. So how do you declare variables? That's quite simple. Let selected text be of kind string, and that's it. So we have created a variable selected text, and we are assigning it to the text that was that's inside the range of the document. So I prepared a little bit because matter of time. Okay, just to show you a few things. So this is how you create if statements in TypeScript. So it's, I think, pretty easy. If in parentheses. Again, this one is a variable declaration. This is for loop. I think that's pretty easy if you so you can get used to it pretty fast. And yeah, what I'm doing here is that I say if the selected text starts with an apostrophe and it ends with that as well, then I want to create a new code action. So I say I create a new object of type code action, and the constructor of code action expects expects the title and optionally a code action kind. I chose refactor extract. I think it's quite, it fits quite well, but yeah. So we, okay, and after that, we can see what a code action has for properties. You can either execute a command if a code action is executed, or you can bind it to some diagnostics. Diagnostics are problems or warnings or errors, something like that. Or what I did now, I'm filling the workspace edit. And that's what I'm doing here. I created an object of type workspace edit, and that has as methods, it has something like create file, delete file, but more important, insert, replace, and delete. And I used these functions, and here he asked the replace for UI, that's an identifier of the file. And as I said, the document is the representation of a file. It has a property of the UI, and yeah, that's quite fine. Then it asks for the range we want to replace. That's the second parameter. I just hand over the range that we selected, and I want to replace it with a fixed text, my label. And it's not directly replaced. So it's just if the workspace edit is applied once, don't know when, then we will replace the text. But that shouldn't be the only action. I iterated over the document lines using document line count and document line adds. The appropriate line, and I said if there's something like a variable section, then I want to return that position. I want to insert at that position some text. So again, I said I want to insert at this document at the position. He's asking here for a line. That's the line where we are currently iterating. I variable. And at the end of the text, at that position, we want to insert something. There we add a line break, 8 spaces, and then my label, so that's a variable declaration, so the variable name, label, our selected text that we just replaced here, and that's our declaration of the variable. And after we created our workspace edit and that kind, we assigned it to the code action, and then we are returning in in a way, and it has one element, the code action. So that's what we did. And let's see what happens. So it's just if we select some text that starts with apostrophe and ends with that, then we should have a code action. Let's try that. First of all, I will select some text, and as you can see, the code action provider is triggered all the time. So you should be aware of that. I will explain why that happens, but you should be aware that the code action provider is triggered all the time. So you should make sure that you have a fast exit or something like that. The reason for that, why that is triggered all the time, is I'm just selecting everything. And as you can see now, here's the light bulb. So for having the light bulb, the code action providers are executed each time. And for that, I have the extract label. So that's the code action. And yeah, I will choose that. And our workspace edit was now executed. So it replaced the label, and we have a new line. We had, after this var, we inserted a line break, 8 spaces, and my label with the text. So that's it. That's how you create how you add new functionalities to your Visual Studio Code. I think it's pretty easy, really. Just we just looked up what we can do in the references in the documentation here, and with a few lines of code, we have our first code action. I think it's pretty amazing how easy it is to extend Visual Studio Code. So I really love that. But that should be enough for how we can add new functionality to that. I want to show you, I mean, how much time do I have left? 10 minutes, I think.
Well, more than 15.
More than 15, oh, nice, okay. Do you have some questions yet then?
No, no questions, except that Matthias Koenig asks if we could get, if he could get, we could get the simple example that you're showing. So let's see how we can... could share it somehow.
Yeah, I don't know. Have you the list of participants?
Well, what I think we will do is that we put a link on underneath the YouTube video with a reference to I think a OneDrive share I have or something like that. Mm. That's the easiest.
Should be possible. Okay. Nice. As I said, it was just to show you how you to make one example how you can add that, but you have endless possibilities. Just scroll through the VS Code API and look what you can do here. You can add new definition providers, new reference providers, and so on and so forth. Okay, now I want to show you how you can interact with built-in commands. So built-in commands, I mean, for example, the definition provider or the reference provider. Of course, we can, let me go here. Of course, we can point us to, on the customer, and here we can say F12, and we went to the destination. We have the destination customer. If we hit Shift F12, so find all references of the customer, then we get multiple results. That's the customer, then customer.reset, and the customer.findFirst. And so that's some results, but it's also possible that we don't get any references or definitions, like on a find first or reset or whatever. And I want to show you how how you can interact how you can execute the Visual Studio Code commands and get the result. So let's say you are positioned on or you have something, you have a procedure, my procedure, and you want to know how often this one is called. And if you know, oh, it's never called, then I can delete it, something like that. You could create a command for that. And I want to show you how we can interact with these commands. So we already have the hello world command, so I will just use that for my demo. And it's pretty, let me just look, exactly. I am pointing here again just to the Visual Studio Code documentation. Again, pretty easy, pretty good documented. And you can find it here under built-in commands. And here they are writing which commands they have. That's not all of them, but some of them. And they say which parameters they expect. I want to use the reference provider. It's this one, VS Code execute reference provider, and it expects a UI, so and a position. So where exactly do we want to hit Shift F12 to get all references? And that I want to do with our extension. So let's go back to the extension TS. And on executing the command hello world, we want Visual Studio Code to execute a built-in command. And that's, now we have to make sure that we haven't typo. So I will just make copy paste. And it expects an array of kind any, so it just expects some parameters. As we said, execute reference provider expects an UI and a position. Here we are. We will just take the example from above. Let's take this one. As I currently don't have in the hello world, I don't have the text document ready. But or should I just get it? I will show you how you get the active text document. VS Code, window, active text editor, and that one has a document. Here you see there's a question mark because you don't have always a text editor opened. So it's possible that you have all editors closed, so it can be that it's undefined. But for now, I will just cast this to show you how that looks like. So just that's a cast in TypeScript. And now I have the current text document in here. And that one again has a UI, and we want to hand over a position as well. That expects a line and a character, and that's I will just make it fix, but I will just say the references line 10 minus 1 because it's starting with the line 0. So I say line 9 and character 8, that is this one, or line character 9. Okay. 9 and 9. There I want to execute the reference provider. And the documentation says it returns to an array of location instances. But it does not resolve directly to an array of location instances. It returns to a promise of that. That means this command is called asynchronously, and we have to resolve the promise. So we have to add this await in front of the command .execute command to resolve the promise. That's TypeScript specific. Let locations VS code dot location away. Nice. But now it's still not confident, as it says type location away or undefined is not assignable to type location, because the docs say that it returns to a location away, but as we just saw, for example, on a dot a customer dot reset or something like that, you don't have references, so it's always possible that you don't get something. So we will add the pipe undefined, and so we get the locations of our position. Now it's still complaining here with the evade, because await says that it says we are currently in a synchronous function, and the quick fix is, did you mean to mark this function as asynchronous? Let's do that. It just writes async for our function, and that's it. Okay, let's test that, and let's see what's inside a location array, as we didn't have that type yet. Reload window. So the extension was now reloaded. And we said if we execute hello world, then we are executing the reference provider at this at that position. Okay, let's do that. Hello world. And as you can see now, we have three locations, and the location consists of a UI, so the identifier of the file where it points to, and the range. So the UI says it's in the file hello world, that's fine. And the first range is pointing to line 9, character 8 to 16. That's the variable declaration. The second one points to it's jumping quite much, so I will go to this one. That's pointing to the line 12, so to the reset. And the last one is pointing to the 13th line. That's the find first, I think it was. So that's how you can execute the built-in command. So a reference provider, a definition provider, and so on. So that's David, also quite powerful, I think.
I forgot to warn at 1:45, but now we have a little over 5 minutes. Sorry that I didn't point out earlier.
Mm. 5 minutes, including exclude. Also, so 5 minutes for me, or in total?
A total 5 minutes, but we can take still a little bit over the hour.
Yeah. Oops. Sorry. Yes, I think that's what it looks like if you are interacting with built-in commands. I just want to recap a few objects that you are most of the time interacting with. So that's a text document that represents a VS Code file. And yeah, that contains the whole text of your of the file and, of course, the path to that. Yeah. The UI itself contains the FS path, and location contains the location of the file, including the range. The range consists just of a start and end position. The position just consists of a line and a character. So yeah, that's a few of the objects that you are using quite much. A variable declaration in TypeScript is just with a colon, and here you can just see again how we can interact with built-in commands. And yeah, if you somewhere read that the function returns a promise or a zenable, something like that, then with the await keyword, you can resolve the promise directly so that you don't have a promise of VS Code locations, but you directly get the VS Code location away itself. Fine. Of course you wanna you don't want to develop your extension and don't do anything with that. So I wanna show you how you can share or publish your extension. Again, that is documented on the Visual Studio Code documentation under testing and publishing. And here it says that you need something. You need the VFCE, that stands for Visual Studio Code Extensions. And I will just install that. I hope that's quite fast now, but I think so, yeah. And I'm already in the webinar folder, but I will show you now. I can execute a command VSC package, and that will create missing publisher name. Oh, sorry, in the package JSON, I'm missing the publisher. Let's call him Ariopa. But now it should be possible. It wants some pre-published scripts where we can. Damn it. I should. It seems that it has some checks if the README is the default one.
Now everybody can download an Ariopa extension.
Yeah, and then you would have that will create. Don't know why it's not working now. Test. Then it will create a VSX file which you can share. So maybe you remember that we had a VSX file from Microsoft. Now it's working. Do you want to continue? Yes, done. Now I have the VSX file and you can share that one. Cool. And to upload it directly to the marketplace, you have to create a publisher, but that's very good documented here in under publishing extensions. So I think that's it for me. Interacting with other extensions, won't have time for that, but I will stop here.
We can make another webinar of that if you
want. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. That's for my side. I don't know. Luke, do you want to exit screen?
There is one, yeah, I'm going to switch screen, and there's one, well, more or less question from Ryan Kearns. He asked, is it possible to, he says, actually, I've got a lot of PowerShell scripts. Can I embed that into my VS Code extension? You know that?
I know it is possible. So if we are looking to, maybe it's good that am I still sharing screen? Yes,
oh, no.
I think so.
Oh, I was sharing.
Ah,
my screen.
Okay. Yeah.
You want to share
but
it
maybe
again?
you know the AL Test Runner extension made by James Pearson.
Yeah.
And he is executing some PowerShell scripts. So it is possible. I've never done it myself, but I know it's possible. Just look up in his repository. It's open source.
Yeah.
And yeah.
AL Test Runner. And I was also answering to Ryan. I know that Waldo had, of course, a bunch of PowerShell scripts before we went to VS Code with all the PowerShell commandlets to merge files, etc. And that he put a lot of that also in his extension. I don't know how he did it, if it was a rewrite, but well, I think yes, indeed, the AL Test Runner is also a good example, and that's an open source one also, so you can go, like you said, to the repository.
Yeah.
David, thank you very much. There are a couple of people out there like Darren. I want to thank David for this. I can't wait to dig into this. Or Mark Rambish saying thank you. So clearly, I think we touched upon a topic where more people are interested in. So great that you were willing to share this. I think you did well. Yes, it's always a challenge of time. And I'm also to blame. I would have, as we agreed, warned you at 50 minutes to go. So sorry for that. And then you understand why I would have liked to have done that, because only 5 minutes to go is a little bit small to adjust anything there. David Singleton is also thanking you. Thank you once again. Thanks everybody for being here. As you can see here again, all the different URLs, use them, or the email if you want to send. We have the thoughts of putting a link to a OneDrive share, whatever, underneath the recording on YouTube or the video on YouTube. So have a look there and stick with us. I also get a tweet, or I see a tweet from Jeremiah Fiska is also thanking you. He was here. We had about 50, almost 60 people attending today, so well, that's a great number. So you did well.
Thanks for not saying that.
Thank you very much. We're going to stop for today, a little bit over the hour, and hope to see you again in 3 weeks' time when Steve Hando will be our speaker. And yes, let's see, David, if we plan another session for an extended part which you haven't had time to deal with today. Thank you.
Yes, thanks for having me.